I can do anything better than you.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can. Yes, I can.
Anything you can be, I can be greater. Sooner or later, I'm greater than you.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am. Yes, I am. I can shoot a partridge with a single cartridge.
I can get a sparrow with a bow and arrow.
I can live on bread and cheese.
And only on that.
Yep.
So can a rat.
Any note you can sing, I can sing higher.
I can sing any note higher than you.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't. Sing that high.
I'm a girl.
Anything you can say, I can say softer.
I can say anything softer than you. Yes, I can. Yes, I can.
I can drink my liquor faster than a flicker.
So good evening, everyone. I am Meg Taubwerk, and I am Rose Tarlow's business partner. It is a pleasure to welcome you all to... Oh my goodness, I think we're also serenading you with some unusual music, to welcome you to Rose Tarlow Melrose House. And many of you, perhaps most of you, have been to this house before, but for those of you for whom it's a first time, I say a particular welcome. You may know that we moved ourselves from Melrose Place to this house in late fall, and as soon as Rose set to work actually arranging the rooms and arranging the furniture and being herself here, she was inspired to start to hold gatherings like this in the house. Many of you know Rose personally, and you know that she is actually a very shy but warm person. And when she saw the gallery coming to life, she was really inspired to use it as a place for people to come and to speak and to be spoken to. So thank you all for joining us. I did find one of my favorite quotes from Rose, because she's not able to be here this evening, she's in France, and I found one of my favorite quotes from her book about entertaining and welcoming and hospitality. And she wrote, "The more you entertain, the easier it becomes. If you entertain frequently, frequency is key, these occasions become delightful variations on a familiar theme." So, here at Melrose House, we are trying to make it a habit to entertain, and I invite you back often. And in this way, we'll be able to expand our circle of friends. This evening, we have two friends from New York. And it's my great pleasure to introduce Joel Barclay and Tom Kligerman of the renowned architecture firm, Ike Kligerman Barclay, of New York and San Francisco. These gentlemen and their partners formed IKBA after meeting in the office of Robert Stern. And their firm has received many, many accolades over the years, including inclusion for well over a decade in the AD 100. So tonight, we are celebrating the publication of their first book called Houses, and what better venue than this house to hear from Joel and Tom. So these gentlemen are highly educated, highly talented, usually highly entertaining, and I know I personally find them highly inspirational. So please join me in welcoming them to the Los Angeles design community.
Thank you, Meg. We are really honored to be here. It's a pleasure and to see everyone, a little humbling to see everyone. Thank you all for coming. See all these friends and colleagues and stuff is really quite amazing. When we were asked to publish a book, is this working properly? It sounds very reverberated. Okay. We really had to sort of look at what we do and sort of think how we work, because we had to take 300 projects, essentially, and 20 years worth of work, and reduce it down to a book that only was able to show 21 projects. So it was quite a task. And we sort of looked at our core and the things we do, and I think probably things that many of you here do. We're very interested in architectural history. As one thing, the other is the client's wishes and desires, their program, and then finally kind of a healthy dash of what we do, of what we want to do at any given time, so a little bit of a victimization of the client in that. And then when Meg invited us to come here, She said, you have to do everything in 20 minutes. And we really kind of thought, well, how are we going to do that? And Joel and I finally realized we could just leave John Ike back in New York and shorten everything. So we came up with a sort of catchy title, Anything You Can Do, Ike Can Do Better. And as we started working on the talk, we realized the speech is much funnier than we are. So we're just going to do a regular presentation, I think. So with that, I'd like to start. As I said, are very interested in architectural history. This is a photograph of one corner of our office, which is also a library. We have about 4,000 books in here, which we use for inspiration. At least people under the age of 30 use, over the age of 35, I guess, use. John and Joel and I sit around one big partner's desk. The three of us face each other and help each other, sort of fostering a lot of good design ideas and stuff like that. Also, a lot of sort of friendly competition. But really, what we like is collaboration, whether it's between the three of us or with our clients and consultants and people like that. This is sort of the world we imagine we live in. You know, a book on Buckingham Palace, some wine, the smell of leather and bronze light fixtures. But the reality is, we realize that this is kind of the reality of what's going on today, and a lot of people, that's their reality. And we think that we bring these two things together pretty successfully, taking advantage of both. We do a lot of work, as I say, because of the of our interest in specific areas and stuff, but we'd like to really focus on three types of building today. One is the shingle style, another is modern buildings, and then lastly, sort of traditional buildings. And these are all watercolors that Joel Barkley does as part of the design process. As we sort of beg him to do them for us, he does them for himself, but part of the way we work and present things. So I'll start with a shingle style house. This is a house so on the low-lying dunes of Martha's Vineyard. We had a very strict height limitation of 24 feet, so the house stretches out the way the dunes do. It's really a blend of traditional and modern. From the outside, if you're going by in a boat, you'd think it was a traditional house maybe from 1920. Elements like that curved bowed gable, which is picked up in other parts of the building, like the chimneys and the flare of the shingles as they meet the ground. From the outside, traditional. Here you see the front door. But the house is very long and thin to let light and air in from everywhere. And on top of that, we carve into it things like this breezeway, which is painted white, which allows light to kind of bounce and reflect into the building, allows air to move through. Or this porch on the ocean side, which lets light into this library, which you can see the windows of on the left. Inside, has sort of all the elements of a traditional beach house, so the worn wooden floors, whitewashed ceilings, the timber, whitewashed brick, but really in kind of a pared down, not exactly Miesian vocabulary, but a little more modern than an otherwise traditional shingle style house. The spaces are loft-like and open. This is the screen porch, which takes up the entire east end of the house. The living room with these 12-foot ceilings with these triple-hung windows that you can slide up almost like they have houses in the southern United States and walk out. I can walk out under those two windows. I'm 6'6", and you can walk right out of the landscape. Master bedroom, kind of like the breezeway, very white-painted wood. Allow the sort of the warmth of the sun to come in and reflect around. But you're always wanting to be in bright, white, large spaces, so included in the house are smaller, more intimate things like this little reading room, all wrapped in cork walls and ceilings, barely wide enough for a sofa. You can put your feet out and sort of, I guess, you know, melt your flip-flops while you read a book. Or this little staircase that links the library upstairs to the master's suite. Elsewhere on the property is the pool, and in the pool house we sort of reinterpreted shingle style. This is a little building that's glass and steel, but it's wrapped in horizontal louvers of teak. They kind of take up the idea of the horizontality of shingles, but also the horizontality of the horizon and the beach and the ocean. Here you see looking out towards the pool with the big sliding doors pulled open. Modern, this is a house that that John Toya and I worked on. John Toya is our partner who runs our San Francisco office. He's standing over there. This is in Connecticut. It's on the top of a hill overlooking from 30 miles away, Long Island Sound. It's so high up. And it's a renovation. That pyramid on the left was an existing building that we had to add on to, which is not an easy thing. Our first pass had sort of little baby pyramids sticking off it and stuff like that. And we finally realized that one of the key things about it was its horizontality. And that's what ended up happening to this wing that sort of pulls off to the right and almost is a sort of a wooden train sailing out to the east over this plinth of granite and fieldstone. And although it's modern, warm materials, the fieldstone, as I mentioned, it also harks to very traditional buildings, so sort of a blend of modern and what we think of some of the best things of traditionalism. But it has, you know, a bass, a modern, a traditional bass. It has a piano nobile. It has this reclaimed Douglas fir roof that sails out almost in the sort of manner of a cornice on an Italianate building or something. Inside, we basically cleaned up the late 70s building, sort of hosed out all the brown tile and black paint and stuff. It looked like a set for Charlie's Angels when we got there. But we really wanted to open up the pyramid, and the notion was this sort of open space with these floating volumes. You see the dining room sitting below the study. Other elements would be that curved wall that wraps a staircase that goes down, even that stack of stones that goes over the pool. The old pool was all existing, and new materials brightened up, new lighting to lighten it up. And it's connected to the new wing by this glass bridge, which glows from underneath, and is, you can see the windows wrapping. So this is sort of a glass synapse that sort of separates the existing old building from the new. And you look down the hallway, and in the distance is the master bedroom, all new. And although a different shape from the pyramid, it too is a big volume, in this case square, with things floating in it to define spaces. In this case, it's that walnut cube, which actually is the dressing room, and defines the bedroom here you see from the bathroom, which is tucked on the other side. The last view of it, looking up the hill from the tennis court, which is behind us, you see the new addition on the side with its sort of cubic aspect. In the distance, you see the chimney of the old part of the building. And then cascading down to us is the stone stair, which sort of echoes the water of the pool flowing over on the left. And all that scruffy grass is actually a meadow. This is our first totally green project. It has geothermal heating, special paint, reclaimed everything. And the meadows now are an amazing refuge for foxes and deer. The grass is literally this high. It's really astounding what lives in that if you don't have a mowed lawn. And by the way, if there's questions afterwards, we'd love to talk more. The thing I want to show you of mine is this, on the sort of traditional vein, is this house, which is about 4,000 miles away. It's in Cabo San Lucas. It sits right on the beach. And what was sort of foisted on us by the developers was that all the houses in this area had to have all the sort of traditional elements of a little Mexican village. So from the street, you have the peaked roofs, terracotta tile, little balconies, and broken up, what are they called, multi-pane windows, and the massing, like this entrance piece, little, almost like little buildings, even though it's one house. You see that staircase going up almost as though you're in a little hill town. But when you open the door, you look through and you immediately see the Pacific. And when you go through, when you get to the other side of the house, we look to a different inspiration, and that is the architecture of the 20s and 30s from Southern California, worked by people like Wallace Neff, where the sort of, you know, his buildings, I'm sure you all know, those big sweeping curves and stuff, where it's a little bit more pared down. Rather than the little tiny punched windows of Neff, we have big windows, but punched. The windows slide and pocket back into the wall, and that curve actually provides privacy. Every room gets its own view, but you're able to have sort of protection from the neighbors, which are literally right next to each other. With the magic of photography, you don't see that. But we create a little lozenge-shaped lawn for the kids and the family to hang out on, and then this negative edge pool that's 130 feet long that wraps the width of the property and sort of forms this glassy barrier between you and the ocean. And there's a little fire pit there with fire coming out of the water and stuff. You can see from this photograph, though, kind of a different look from the front of the house. Or this one here, looking to people like Luis Barragan, the sort of flying stucco beam, a fountain pouring into the swimming pool. And inside, much like the house in Martha's Vineyard, open, light coming from both sides. You can see it coming down the staircase. It's also coming in from windows off to the left of the camera here. But the whole thing really an open, almost loft-like, like the house in the vineyard, but in a Mexican vocabulary. We look to the sort of mural traditions of Mexico, the bright colors of that yellow wall and the blue niches in the kitchen here, all very open, even the green of that margarita yet to be made on the countertop there, the sort of limes. Other parts of the house obviously more private, like the master bedroom, which is its own sort of villa unto itself. And here you see other little things we brought in, like the Moroccan tile, but that giant window slid back into the wall. It's 10.5 feet tall and 8.5 feet wide. So you can really live outdoors, live in this, I don't know if you all have been to Cabo, the most incredible environment in terms of temperature stuff. Behind me is another door like that, which opens up onto this little courtyard, private courtyard that the master bedroom shares, where you have your own hot tub. Someone said to me, I'd never seen a green pool. So the next day I decided to make this pool green. They have your own fireplace. It opens out to the bigger pool. And your guests and the rest of the family have their own larger terrace, which is on the ocean side of the living room here with the latias that filter light down. So you're sort of protected and cool and able to sit outside in the shade. But again, the great thing about Cabo is outdoor living. And here you see the pool. End of the day, you come out to relax. The moon is just coming up and you're able to sort of soak in the environment down there. With that, I hand it over to Joel.
Thank you. This is my turn at the Shingle Style in Greenwich, Connecticut. Unlike Tom's more modern synthesis of modernism with the Shingle Style, I decided to look at traditional Swedish vernacular architecture. The house is in Greenwich, as I said, and because it's in Greenwich, they were more lenient with the height of the house. We made the roof here 40 feet, so we were able to do a profile that really reaches upward. Another thing was we had a very adventurous client who liked the idea of taking the coloration of a Swedish barn we'd seen in an image that had a black body with white windows. And I think it was either Tom or John who had the brilliant idea of inverting the colors on the entry side so that when you come in, you get a really nice, light, friendly embrace. Now, entering the house was something we had a lot of fun with. I'm glad that Michael Graves isn't here tonight because in school, Michael Graves always insisted that you make a very clear entryway with no confusion whatsoever. I couldn't really figure out where to put the front door. This is a view of the garden front. And in the distance, kind of in the crotch of the two pieces, you see what is the front door. The front door is seldom, if ever, used as the primary entry because it goes out to a family terrace and the lawn. But inside, the interiors were done with Alexa Hampton, but inside, as you look out to the garden, you can see the door holds a very symbolic place for the family in the center hall to feel connected to the back. And that's a Dutch door. I guess it's a Swedish version of a Dutch door. Another view of the same room shows how it's illuminated by a fireplace. And it is the center of activity with the stairs coming down into it as well. So, I'm a bad clicker here. So how do you actually enter the house? Well, in John's or Tom's white courtyard, you see this framed vista, but the vista's not of your typical stair going to the second floor. It's a landscape stair that actually takes you up to the higher levels of the garden. So if you're not careful, you might miss the real door into the house, which is to your left. It's the difficulty of the site, but the opportunity that I thought was interesting, and I think beneath it all, I was just trying to tie the inside and the outside together in an interesting fashion. Going back to the inside, we use boards here a lot the way Tom used boards, but not in the same minimal fashion. This is a traditional detail that we saw in a house by Linnaeus in Sweden, and it just is boards coming up and then coming out at an angle. And then once we started using the boards, we really got carried away, not that far. We really got carried away. We just put boards everywhere. We couldn't stop. Modern. This is my modern project, which more than Tom's addition, it was a blank slate. It is an entire floor of a butter warehouse in Tribeca. And to keep the butter cool, they had an entire foot of unreinforced concrete weighing down what is a wooden floor structure. The other bad thing about the concrete was it deprived us of a foot of ceiling height, and it was a very broad horizontal space. Ceiling height was very important. So we took all the concrete out, except for the bits in the lower left, and we made a concrete divider so you enter kind of at a higher level so you wouldn't have to redo the elevator, and also so you'd have kind of a, I don't know, a sitcom entry like Mary Tyler Moore, you come in higher. And it worked out pretty well. So that conquered the problem of the concrete. Then we had a lighter problem, which was light itself. How do you get light to the center of an 80-foot space with windows just at each end? It's a big problem in such a horizontal slice. So one of the ways we did that was by the use of translucent panels. Here's a shot between a study and the main living space, and what you get is light and privacy at the same time. The other technique was Tom's technique that he talked about previously about putting objects within other objects rather than making walls to define the space. So here, a dressing room is made by a bamboo cabinet. The only wood in the apartment was bamboo, which we thought was nice and green. Another device that Tom and I shared. He had the illuminated bridge, but I've decided to highlight columns, and it doesn't really show up well on the bottom, but I had columns paired with uplights, and here in the living room, we made a rug with an egg-shaped cutout that accommodates the uplight on the column. And what the floor did, what the rug did, was it made a plane on the floor that sort of transgressed the boundary of the 16-foot grid. So we had a bigger, you felt like you were in a bigger living room than the structure wanted to allow. The materials were important here. We wanted very comfortable, warm material, so we used a lot of felt. And we also used a lot of gray flannel, as the client had been on Wall Street for many, many years, and he felt comfortable with gray flannel. More planes, translucent planes. These are a shifting, I like to think it's kind of a shifting, dynamic, Mondrian-esque composition that changes depending on what you want to cover up in the closets or the kitchen. And then going back to the original, one of the original problems, which is bringing light into the middle. What we did is we lowered a plane that we had to have to cover the neighbor's plumbing anyway, and we did a constellation of downlights in the middle. Then we made all the furniture white and all the art white so that you really do have a light apartment at the center. Traditional. This is a house near Charlottesville, Virginia. It's in Green Springs Historic District. It's a 1,000-acre horse farm. It's adjacent to a house by the 19th century A.J. Davis, so it was once part of that property. Sorry. Here you see horses out in front of the house. Now, this is what they call in Virginia a manor house. And to me, a manor house implied something strict, symmetrical, Palladian, something like Monticello by Thomas Jefferson, which is very nearby. But you can see we did something different here, and it's a technique very akin to what Tom did in Mexico, which is break the building up into a lot of bits. However, the vision was a little different here. I wanted it to be an acropolis because it's on such a big property. So here you can see it's broken into a very casual, it is a farmhouse, into very casual bits, but the portico is one of the elements that has the formality you need in a house like this. So here's a Greek Revival portico. Beyond, you can see a formal entry hall. But altogether, we want it to be a casual acropolis that would welcome all the critters of a farm, dogs, cats, stray horses. And then porches were a very essential part of this because of the desire, you know, to see the beautiful Blue Ridge Mountains. And also, weather watching is very important on a farm. We didn't have to worry about neighbors the way Tom had to worry about neighbors, but we did have to worry about horses staring back at us. And John Eyck's idea was to do this English form, very symmetrical, very rigid, that we borrowed from a 1920s stable by Harry T. Lindeberg, a New York architect. And I think the contrast between the formality of the horse's house and the informality of the client's house works together somehow.
And now I'm going to pretend I'm John Eyck. This is a house on the shore in New Jersey. It's a vacation house that was, John did, very early on. I think within 2 years of opening the office, this was completed and it ran an architectural digest and kind of put us on the map in a small way. And a lot of what we've been talking about is sort of the blending of things like modern and traditional. And this house was the blending of English cottage style, notably Lutyens, but also the shingle style in sort of the shingle style in a style that we sort of call shinglish around the office. When John said, I'm going to do it in dark green and everything, I was mortified. And sure enough, the kids in the town called the Dracula House. Tim Burton used it in a movie because it was so creepy looking, but actually, inside it's very light. Almost every room has three exposures, and many of them have two. And then he said, I'm going to do drunken weave shingles, and that really sent me around the bend. We ended up driving down the Christmas Eve in the rain to see it because I was so freaked out about it. We got down there, it was pouring rain, and we had this amazing roofer from down south. It was like, you know, the Seven Dwarfs working away, raining Christmas Eve, and in fact, it was pretty amazing. But the notion of this very taut but wavy shingle style, very clean triangular element of the roof on that dormer. And likewise, the brick treated very simply, no moldings, just sort of clinker brick wrapping volumes in the same way that the green shingles wrap the rest of the building. Oops. Oh. Inside, we kind of softened things a little bit, realized people actually have to live in it, so more traditional use of moldings, but bringing the outdoors in, the bluestone floors come in, the shingles come in, but they go from being green shingles to being these little fish scale shaped shingles about this big. Moldings, as I said before, and this sort of screen that looks almost like it was added at some point. You can see the point of the ceiling poking through that molding at the top. The ceiling is the same material as you have out on the porch. And then all the way at the back of the site is this little pool house, which has all the elements of the other building. But it's sort of interesting because you can see the scale of the drunken weave shingles on this little building. Like, it's much more kind of aggressive. But again, this is sort of a little, it's like the offspring of the big house, sitting here with this bar overlooking this elliptical pool, just, you know, as I said, at the back of the property. The modern project we show for John is this apartment in a 1948 building that was designed by Skidmore, Owings & Merrill in Manhattan. And this one, a very sort of white, spare interior. It's really almost like a gallery. You walk in, this curved wall kind of pushes you diagonally into the place. But like the other projects, the notion of a cube to define spaces glowing. This is a glass cube that houses the staircase, and it's sort of the axle off of which all the rooms spin. The living room, which is done in a very muted palette of white and very light oak, a lot of furniture from the mid-century of the last century, furniture by people like Saarinen and others like that, Swedish rugs, but almost like gallery lighting to light things. This is a chest by Gio Ponti that became the inspiration for the plaster walls. You can see those sort of floating panels of wood picked up in these sort of floating blocks of plaster. You can see that even more here in the dining room. No artwork in the house. Really, the wall is enlivened by this kind of manipulation of the wall surface. And other than that, the sort of, you know, furniture and glasses and the stuff of everyday life is what's set off against that white backdrop. One last view of this apartment. Again, that cube on the right glowing, the sort of frosted glass panels like Joel's loft, which slide across and separate the breakfast room from the front hall here. And then a view out into Manhattan, and a view to the fish and your fish sticks sort of here in the breakfast room. And last, what we chose for John to show in the traditional is this house, which is a building. It's actually in the same town as that dark green building. John is very smart. He does things very close by. He doesn't have to travel. But this is based on a villa by Palladio. It's a villa he did for Count Rosina, who was his great patron, the guy who really launched him. And like that villa, sits on a flat plain. Unlike that villa, it sits on the Atlantic Ocean, not on the Brenta River. But the same tall towers span by the middle of the building. In this case, it's almost like a bridge. You can see it's open underneath. And in our sort of imagination, or John's imagination, it was a house that was built at one time, and then someone came along, maybe with Carlos Scarpa or somebody like that, and enclosed this big space with this sort of polished stainless steel and glass curtain wall, sort of create this great indoor-outdoor porch. And we sort of, you know, that you can see a sort of Scarpa-esque fireplace in the distance. We sort of imagine the owner is actually a sort of bigger-than-life guy who, at the drop of a hat, will literally have 300 people over. The other side of the morning, and then 3 o'clock in the afternoon, there's 300 people wandering around the house. So not only does light and air flow in and out, but also the way it's designed, people can flow in and out onto the terraces inside and out. More intimate in the towers, more intimate spaces like this little sitting room with oak and stuff, but traditional materials treated in a kind of modern way. Or this staircase that takes you up to the master bedroom, which sits over the living room, which is these big chunks of timber and this sort of modern Greek meander railing that goes up. And finally, this view looking back towards the house, where even though it's on the Atlantic Ocean, the pool is really where they spend their time. You can see the blue roof reflecting the blue of the pool and the blue window, so this sort of watery sky palette.
In conclusion, John Eich, Tom, and John Toya and I have an unusually collaborative practice. Most architects work with teams of people outside of their office, as we do. But we have the benefit of actually sitting in one room as we work. We often ask each other's opinions and chime in with unsolicited constructive criticism. But I do think that this slightly competitive air is what makes our office healthy, because we always force each other to do our very best work. And I think in the slides you can see our work ranges stylistically to a great degree from project to project. That's because the variables of there being the distinct partners, each addressing context, history, but most importantly what the client wants, is the reason for this. We hope that through all these different projects that there's a common thread of good details within a building of good character that gives us a signature of sorts. Thanks, and if you have questions, we'd like to answer them.
Do you have any work out here on the West Coast?
Oh, yes.
We do. Well, we have a West Coast office that John runs, but we've done a number of things in Palo Alto. We've done a big building at Stanford University, but also a house. We're doing a project in Pasadena. We've done a fair amount of work in Hawaii. We're doing something in Vancouver, so in Cabo. So we do West Coast work and love being out here. Aspen.
It's great to have a foot out here.
Yeah. We invite you guys to have an office in New York so you don't feel like we're out. We're not trying to poach. Come poach with us.
Not so far. So far, I'd say it's about the same. The building we did at Stanford is pretty historically influenced. And it was neat to be able to work on an institutional building where you could do that kind of work. We really enjoyed it.
Actually, the mandate there was to pick up on the old architecture of Stanford. They were trying to kind of...
The Richardsonian Romanesque.
The Richardsonian stuff. And so the building is traditional in that way. So there was a clear interest in history of that. That was really what we were told to do.
It's a building for the Stanford Institute for Economic Policy Research, which is a school where people come in from other disciplines to study economics and work on policy.
When you don't have a mandate, what drives your decision to a particular idiom?
Usually the client has an idea, but sometimes it just depends on what you haven't done and what you're interested in.
But also, like I said, there's always a historical context. But it's interesting, those the two, and you can kind of pick your history. That dark greenhouse that John did and the last house we showed you, that Palladian one, are both in the same town. It was interesting because in the 1880s, it was all shingle style, and then that kind of gave way in the 20s to Mediterranean. So, you know, there's a lot of history you can play with. There's a lot you can begin with. And that's generally where we start. So you're not locked in. There's a lot of freedom, usually. And as I say, we just make it up if there's a, just at some point.
Did you design the horse barn yourselves?
Yeah. Well, Harry T. Lindeberg did, actually. That's the architect who inspired us.
Okay.
But we had a consultant who knew about stalls and stuff like that. So.
Did you enjoy it?
Oh, we loved it. The problem is I'm allergic to horses. So. I come within 50 feet and I start sneezing. I'm so allergic to horses. So I'll never be able to see it again. But there's an apartment in the middle with the horse people who live in it. And there's kind of an, I wish I should have shown a shot, but there's an opening in the middle for ventilation. It really works well. It's like a chimney. Sucks all the bad air out.
But it's amazing. We've done a number of barns. I didn't show up, but on that project in the vineyard, there's a barn. That we found the frame in Maine and reassembled. It was from 1752, and then we made this very modern building in terms of function, but it looks like a building from 1800. You can't tell that it's new. It doesn't house horses. It houses pygmy goats and designer chickens and stuff like that. It's not exactly a working farm, but it's fun. I mean, the goats are this tall. They're adorable. Beth.
What's the range of your work? So in this book particularly is poems, but I think you mentioned the living theater and a restaurant. Can we talk about the
percentage?
Well, it really ranges, and you know, people sometimes look at this and go, God, you guys are way too fancy for us. But the truth is, if it's interesting, we'll do almost anything. Maybe the best example of that is there's a house in New Jersey by... Bailey Scott, you know, an English arts and crafts architect who, it's his only house in America, and historically interesting, a fantastic building, the local architecture, McKim, Mead & White. And the people came to us, and all they wanted to do was two bathrooms for their kids, and we couldn't wait. So things from that small to the building at Stanford, we've done boats, we've done Gulfstream jets, we've done parties, weddings. So a real range.
But our
if we've heard of it, we can do it.
But our hearts are really with houses, and that's 91% of our work, probably.
91.5.
91.5.
come to your office knowing which one of you they want to work with? Obviously, they've worked with you before, but do they?
Good question.
It is a good question. That's something we've wrestled with. We finally have a new policy because it used to be...
you just grab what comes in.
Whoever picked up the phone.
And then don't leave town.
Yeah, don't leave town because you lose jobs. But it's also the baby bird syndrome where the first person a new client talks to is that's all they want to talk to. And if they get someone else, they feel like they're being sort of dumped. So now we're very careful. The call comes in. Isadora, our assistant, speaks to them. She has a list of questions. And then it's... We decide who among us should call back.
We talk about it.
Yes, we sit around our desk and we talk.
Great question.
Friendly, in a friendly way. But it's that has been an issue.
Can I ask another question?
Sure.
So do you, you guys still are really hands-on with your particular projects?
Yeah.
That's great.
Sometimes it's great.
It's great in a life-shortening kind of way. I'm actually only 26.
Do you handle the interior design as well, or do you work with outside?
Both.
Both.
About 50-50.
Well, it varies from between us. John Ike, who's not here, he probably does more of his interiors than, well, you do more than I do.
I'm happy to have someone else do them. I'm an architect, and I like... we've done a lot of work with, Ellie Coleman, and if you know Coleman and Kravis, and...
We mentioned Alexa.
Alexa Hampton, and it's great because it...
Paul Wiseman.
Brings a whole different... You learn so much that way, in terms of collaboration. Stuff you wouldn't do, you wouldn't think of.
Is there anybody here we work with who we didn't mention? I don't think so.
Have you heard, I've mentioned
Wow.
Wow.
Don't know about it. I bet John Ike does, because John Ike loves Geoponte, and we have about 12 books on Geoponte that John bought in a special little corner. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's good to know about.
Very good.
Did you have a good time doing the book?
Yeah. I tell you something that we wanted to do for a long time, and we floundered around for years, and Keith Granite finally introduced us to an amazing agent who pulled it together, and we couldn't have done it without her. But the whole thing was fun. It's interesting for anybody to do if you get the chance, because the work is re-presented to you in a way you've never seen before. You really think about things differently. It was fun. It's a fair amount of work. It's less work than promoting it, but it's all fun. I mean,
Did you find that you had to re-photograph?
Well, all these photographs over time, so it's wonderful to see all that work and all that money you've spent over the years kind of coming together into a product. It's really exciting.
But one of the reasons we had one of the reasons Monticelli did it, and we actually had four offers from publishers, was because we had the photography. Luckily, I guess the influence of Robert Stern, who's so good at books and so good at documenting. We hired pretty much from the start the best photographers that we could afford, and thank God we did, because it was just a matter of editing. So that I'm just glad we did that early on. As Joel says, as expensive as it is, worth it. Okay. Well, thank you again.
Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you, Meg, and everybody at Rose Tallow.
I can jump a hurdle.
I can wear a girdle.
I can knit a sweater.
I can fill it better.
I can do most anything.
Can you bake a pie?
No.
Neither can I.
Anything you can sing, I can sing sweeter.
I can sing anything sweeter than you.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.